coupling is plotted here, the restrictions on the export of coupling versus the dark matter mass, and you see that the whole chunk of parameters is already eliminated by the most recent experiments, Pandias and Lux, and in the region of very small masses, these experiments run out of sensitivity, but at that level, in that region, the Higgs boson would decay to two dark matter particles, and that closes the red region, so in particular it closes that small range there below 10 GeV or so. So one has a predictive general state. Dark matter is stable because of the neutrino. Another idea concerning dark matter and neutrinos is due to Ernest Mach, exactly a very nice idea. The idea is that neutrinos are light because they don't get masses at the free level. Their masses are radiated as a consequence of some Z2 symmetry that prevents the free level mass. And the same Z2 symmetry also implies that the mediators circulating in this graph, one of them, either Venn or Scalar, is stabilized by the same symmetry. This is a very nice idea of Ernest. Unfortunately, his original model was a bit poor, so we generalized it by adding to the fermion sector not only a singlet but also an isotriplet, and this way we can actually mimic supersymmetry dark matter without supersymmetry. In other words, dark matter, if fermionic, it can have both isotriplet and isosinglet pieces, and this gives the model substantial more possibilities from the phenomenological point of view. And the consistency relies on the validity of this Z4 symmetry, which does the double job of stabilizing dark matter and making the neutrino mass radiated. Notice we are talking about Majorana neutrinos, it's photogenic Majorana neutrinos. And one can actually check that, again, thanks to this extension, adding this fermion and this triplet, these two triplets, fermion triplet and scalar triplet, one can now extrapolate the validity of the Z2 symmetry, which is important part of the construction, all the way up to the unification state. So the model is consistent and predictive, and we can do lots of physics in it. Very nice for a graduate student thesis. Now another idea, again following Ernest Mach, in fact he's one of the authors of this paper, is to play this photogenic idea, but cloning it with the previous idea that the dark matter stability is because of the directness of the neutrinos. So in this case, one imposes, instead of a quarticity electron number, a triality electron number, which makes dark matter stable. Dark matter is the scalar mean here. And neutrinos pick up a Dirac mass. This is a Dirac mass, which follows at the two-loop level. So it's a two-loop photogenic variant, which instead of Majorana neutrinos leads to Dirac neutrinos, and is based on this triality electron number. And moreover, it has a Goldstone boson, which is the Dirac boson. So, again, the physics is a non-supersymmetric scalar wing particle. This is the same restriction as drawn before, all the way from 0 to 200 GeV. And in the region of small masses, the constraint comes as before from IDXC, from searches of invisible Higgs decay. But in contrast to previously, we had just the red part, and now we have these lower parts, which may have a more restrictive bound on the parameter controlling the Higgs portal interaction, direct interaction of dark matter. The reason is that the Higgs boson here can decay invisibly either to a pair of dark matter particles or to a pair of Dirac. So that squeezes its constraint and makes dark matter searches more sensitive than in the previous genetic model in the region of low mass. Now I move gears to a no-wing dark matter candidate. And this no-wing dark matter candidate is almost archaeology, was proposed more than 20 years ago with Venya Berezinski. The idea is the Majorana is the Goldstone boson that you get whenever you break electron number spontaneously without gauging it. So that's the Goldstone boson. It's very much like the axion. It is the electronic brother of the axion. And it is it was imagined right from the beginning that this guy could pick up a mass. For example, you can just add by hand some soft breaking terms in the scalar potential, or if you are more fancy, you can imagine that these terms are produced by gravitational instant effects, in the same way as the axial mass comes from the QCD instant effects. And motivated by phenomenology, we wanted to use as a benchmark value kilovolt, because kilovolt, that range corresponds to the genes, galactic genes length in structural formation. So the model was suggested. That time there was only the COBE experiment measuring the CLD. Today we have, of course, WMAC and PLOT. So one needs to reevaluate the viability of this scenario in taking into account the measurements of the CLD, which we now have. That was done in this paper. And this is what one finds. The consistency with the CLD is studied. The difference is the Majorow is the mother of the neutrino mass. It is a Goldstone boson. By Noether's theorem, by necessity, it couples to a pair of neutrinos. And by necessity, that coupling is proportional to the neutrino mass. Hence, the Majorow decays to a pair of neutrinos. It is unavoidable. But the decay rate is very small because it's proportional to the mass of the decaying particle, it's proportional to the square of the neutrino mass, and inversely proportional to the scale which characterizes lepton number symmetry breaking. So typically, you can require consistency with the CFD in order to find out the restrictions on the lifetime of this data. The lifetime, of course, must be longer than the age of the universe, but by how much you have to determine through the effect that it has in the CMB. And the effect lies in the low multiple region of the power spectrum, which is difficult to measure experimentally. We did not do it on purpose, it happens that way. That is where the cosmological signature of this decaying dark matter model exists. And concerning direct detection, of course, this has no direct detection through nuclear recoil, this is not a wind, but it has an indirect detection, because as a pseudoscalar, the Majorow, like the pi zero, decays to two gammas. And this decay, if it lies in the kilovolt range, would lead to monochromatic gamma line in the X-ray region. In principle, that is the region which can be covered by Chandran mission. If one tries to extrapolate the Majorow to larger masses, that's a subtle thing. One has to think the Majorow here in this region is warm. If you extrapolate it higher, it becomes cold. And in that region, you may even touch the range of sensitivity of the Fermilab instrument. So dark matter Majorows work very well, as far as we tell. And for some strange reason, they are not possible. Except now that our friend Ringwald is basically doing an axiom version of this, basically generalizing what we did through addition of the axiom. Basically, making the axiom and the Majorow really equivalent to each other, which they did not. Now, one thing that one can try with this Majorow dark matter is to kill three birds with a single shot. Basically, the model requires the existence of some complex scalar which breaks lepton number through its back expectation value. This way, it gives rise to neutrino masses. It has, as a goal, because of the spontaneous breaking of global symmetry, a Goldstone boson which picks up some kilovoltish or higher mass due to gravitational instanton, that is the dark matter. And provided the Higgs potential is sufficiently flat, one can use the real part of the same field to drive inflation, explaining why today we have this near isotropy in the CMB, even though the photons that we are talking about were not even causally connected from the start. So this is a very tempting possibility, and more or less works. It leads basically to this black branch corresponding to Higgs-like inflation, and we are leaving only half of the stuff which is printed in the transparency. This is the region indicated by Bicep 2, which motivated the paper. In green we have the region now indicated by Planck, actually the joint region. In green is the joint region, indicating that this is a viable scenario. Finally, in this kind of scenario, one can always have type 1 seesaw leptogenesis. In other words, the auto-equilibrium decay of the right-handed neutrino, which provides type 1 or general seesaw masses, generates the baryon number, the lepton asymmetry, which is reconverted into baryon asymmetry after the electron crystallization. And this scenario is actually, it proceeds in a similar way to type 1 seesaw leptogenesis, but a bit different, because one must take into account the dynamical degrees of freedom associated to the baryon. So it is more complex. Another possibility, dark matter from free synergy, possibility of putting together dark matter and neutrinos. First, it could be an accident. And this can be modeled if you take a flipper group that is the double cover of something else, then when it breaks to the something else, it automatically leads to a set to parity symmetry, which may be used to stabilize dark matter. It's kind of a trivial example. There is a less trivial possibility that we start with an unbroken, with a flavor group. Here is written A4, but it could be B7, delta 27, whatever. And you have another abelian flavor group, there are many choices for that, and you break it to Z2 parity or many other possibilities, Z2, Z3, Z4, Zn. So this is a recipe for model building. Identifying, saying the following, the symmetry that stabilizes the dark matter is nothing but an unbroken subproduct of the symmetry which explains the Debian oscillations. So this opens the possibility of connecting these two indications of new physics in the standard model. Again, typically these models lead, this is the F4 example, the cross-section of dark matter detection versus the weak mass for a particular model. But this is a general idea. Finally, a word about supersymmetry. I almost did not mention supersymmetry in this talk, but in principle it could be there. Typically, SUSY leads to neutralino as dark matter candidate with by hand imposition of a parity conservation. However, it ignores, typically these models ignore neutrino mass generation. If it is a high scale, it's so fine. There should be no big change. But if you go to neutrino masses generated at low scale, then what happens is that the profile of the LSP changes, and it is typically no longer than the neutralino, but it is this neutrino-like object. And this changes the phenomenology slightly, but changes. But it is still in the category of wimps. SUSY may also lead to no wimps, and this is a novel possibility. The idea here is that SUSY is the origin of the neutrino mass. SUSY generates massive neutrinos by itself because it is spontaneously break R parity. Because of this, it generates neutrino masses, which are consistent with experimental data and lead to a lot of ways to test the neutrino properties, for example, in high-energy colliders. Concerning dark matter, one needs to assume here that the gravitino is the dark matter, is the light, is the LSP. But even being the LSP, it is not prevented from decaying because of R parity is not conserved. The idea is that R parity violation is the origin of the neutrino mass. The neutrino mass is intrinsically supersymmetric. Hence, the LSP is no longer stable, the gravitino decays, and it decays typically to neutrino and gamma. But the decay is doubly suppressed. It is suppressed gravitationally, and it is suppressed because this violates our parity. And our parity violation is a measure of the neutrino mass. Hence, these coefficients here are tiny numbers and connecting, let's say, for inner to neutrino. So it leads to, again, the gain dark matter with very, very long lifetimes. The gravitino we assumed to have been produced after inflation. So here is the heat temperature, and here is the mass of the gravitino. This is the, here is more or less QGV, 10GV, this is the graphical line. So you see that the region that this, where this model can be tested, in here, it can be tested in many ways, because it produces the gamma line, which can be tested. Fermilab observatory, Fermilab observation in the sky, and it can also be tested because it produces a neutrino line, so potentially neutrino telescopes like IceCube could also try to catch the neutrino line coming from the gravitino decay. So here I put the constraints from Fermi on the search for gamma lines from dark matter gravitino decays. Is the yellow region that is ruled out. So gravitino must be lighter than, let's say, 10 GeV. On the other hand, this is a SUSY model. So SUSY implies gluinos, and in this upper triangle, this is ruled out because gluinos would already have been seen at the LHC, and they have not been seen. And the lower triangle is ruled out, let's say, of this paper theoretically, because gluinos will be too heavy to be of importance to solve the hierarchy, cage hierarchy problem. So the interesting region is indicated there, and one may try to study within that region the consequences of, for example, the existence of the neutrino line. So, in conclusion, our neutrinos, as the most ubiquitous particle in the universe, neutrinos may explain the dark matter through warm dark matter Majorow, cold dark matter Majorow, also through weak dark matter in the model that I have explained. And it is not the neutrinos themselves who play the role of dark matter. Dark matter, so to say, emerges as a theory in the sense that the ingredients postulated to account for neutrino properties also bring in all the ingredients required to solve the dark matter problem. And in fact, this happens here in the evolution of the universe. This is the Big Bang, this is where we are now. This could well happen at the moments of the universe corresponding to the lateral phase transition. At the first 10 to the minus 10 seconds in the life of the universe, and it is in this range where one can, in principle, seek for an explanation of the major cosmological problems that we have today. The understanding of the large-scale isotropy of the universe could come from inflation. Inflation should lie here. Dark matter candidate, as I mentioned, if we are closely connected with neutrinos, again, they could lie either here or maybe even at the lateral scale itself. Parthenogenesis, if it happens through leptogenesis, again, here. And it is not inconceivable that all these four the problems are actually different facets of the same. They have a common denominator. The model of generating neutrino mass may kill four things with a single shot. It is not necessarily so. This is just a possibility. You could also play with making models where the neutrino masses and dark matter are combined, or the neutrino masses and inflation, or the neutrino masses and baryogenesis, or three together, etc. Dark energy I have not mentioned. We have no understanding of dark energy. And this kind of theories of the neutrino mass lead to many phenomenological implications, for example, and also theoretical features. The issue of stability of the standard model vacuum is trivially solved by the neutrino mass generation. Boundedness from below, the issue of the axis of Radal poles, etc., new Higgses, new decay modes of the Higgs, the possibility of probing the neutrino properties at the LHC, the possibility of unification without gap embedding, the possibility of non-unitarity in neutrino oscillation. This is very important point right now, very hot topic for people designing the new generation of experiments. I enter other things which are maybe not so exotic. Letter flavor violation and CP violation, unsuppressed by the smallness of the three of us. Letter flavor violation may be residing only at collider energies, not at low energies, etc. So, I think this brings me to the conclusion of the many pathways that take us from the physics of neutrinos to the world of new physics. If you want to spend some money, you have more of this in our book. Thank you.
Any question from the audience?
No, they have actually analyzed their data for this possibility.
So
the data, the bounds exist.
So what's
the... Not exactly for our model. They analyzed their data for a variant of our scenario, which was developed by Carlos Muñoz in Madrid. Mm-hmm. And he has a name for it, next whatever. But it is absolutely similar to the phenomenology. Again, a few GV, they get a 10 GeV bound for their model, which is extremely,
10 GeV for the mass of
for the mass of the gravitino.
Yeah, okay. But what about the neutrino?
Sorry?
What about the neutrino? So they take the input from the masses of the neutrino to bound
the masses of the neutrinos are what they are for the solution experiments, 10 to the minus electrovolt scale, the small.
First transparency. Can you explain which is which? What's the two different curves?
The two is for normal and inverse element. There are two spectra that are, from the point of view of today's measurements, they are basically equivalent statistically. You cannot tell the difference. One of the goals of future experiments is to decide what is the correct higher.
So, if you have to make a prediction, which experiment will resolve this first?
Well, it is not an easy task. It is not an easy task.
Juno, Pengu...
Dune has good chances because it has a broad band beam. That gives it better chances than Nomad or T2K for many purposes. But there is one thing which I did not mention. Which is a new development. If the neutrino gets its mass from CISO, the electromagnetic mixing rate should not be unitary. Everybody assumes unitarity. We also assume unitarity when we do. If unitarity is lost, Of course, it depends by how much. There are limits. These limits allow 1% variation, 1% of the partner. Then what happens, how can I go in a way that I don't go one by one? What happens is that the seesaw introduces a new city phase. And the new city phase introduced by the seesaw can get confused with the standard ionic perspective. When you write the neutrino appearance probability, you start with a new beam of neutrinos, and you try to detect the electron neutrino component in there as a result of oscillation. Then what you find is that there is an interference term in the probability, which is sensitive to a combination of the city phases, let's say the sum. So it is impossible to disentangle. And we have a great problem in searching for CP violation, which is the main goal of this experiment, is to test the CP violation in the electron sector because they are theories, because the angle is large. So what happens here is that our neutrinos, the mixing matrix of our neutrinos, is no longer limited, but it is pre-multiplied by a matrix which can always be brought to this triangular form, where there are new entries, diagonal entries are close to 1, of diagonal entries are small, let's say percentage. This means that the neutrinos are not orthonormal. This is actually something old time ago, we suggested that neutrinos should not be strictly orthonormal. And if this happens, this is you find the CP confusion, because this is the standard delta CP, this is the new delta CP associated to seesaw, and you have regions of confusion that you have to. And Tune is the best experiment for handling this, and in fact we are right now trying to study this in detail, the level also of simulating the experiment. And it has better chances because the beam is broader than, for example, the normal beam.
Any questions? So, if not, let's thank Jose, I think.
Coffee.
I think we have a coffee break now.